Rudolph Kharatyan, I would say probably one of the most illustrious creative people that I know. You've had a lifelong sort of journey with art, whether that's painting or dancing. You are a ballet dancer, a choreographer, director,
former
dancer, director, artist. So I want to get to know who Rudolph Kharatyan is, and how is it that one person can embody so many aspects of creativity, from playing the tar or the guitar or the violin to painting to dancing. So maybe to make it easier, we sort of do this chronologically and start off
from
how your early childhood led you to this path. You were born in Yerevan?
I was born in Yerevan a long time ago.
We won't tell anybody.
And my family, they were in love with the art, and they wanted me to do everything. So every night in our house, small apartment, I would say, my parents was inviting the relatives just to have a party, small party. I mean, it was dancing, singing, and they were forcing, my father especially, was forcing me to dance, to sing. I was very shy, and I was saying, no, no, I cannot. And he was taking me to learn playing guitar. And then my mother wants me to play the violin, and my sister was playing violin. Art was part of our life, and that's how I was growing. And finally, one day, some teachers from ballet school came to our school, and it was some of the time when we were doing physical activity. They saw me, and then they said, oh, you should come to our school. And they kind of recruit me, and I start going to this school for every day. It was from the morning to 5-6, and then I was going to the National Ballet, being part of the, like, as a apprentice.
How old were you at this time?
I went to that school, I was 12 years old, and then when I was 14, I was in all the ballets, and I was learning everything to do from the corps de ballet. And then before graduating the school here in Armenia, I was dancing even solo things with the company.
Okay, is that, how did the 12, 14, 15 year old Rudolph feel about that? I mean, is that something, was it what you really wanted to do, or was it just?
Not really. I honestly, I hate ballet. When I was watching ballet on the TV, it was so strange. It was associated with the female things.
Right.
So, what is this? But and then going to the ballet, I was very disciplined boy, because my father was military, and I
your father was in the military?
Yeah, in the military, and I admired this discipline of...
That's probably all you saw, too, at home, discipline, right?
Oh, yeah. So, I was there until I was 16, 17, and gradually I start getting into to understand that I can express myself, I can say who am I, and
through your dance.
Through my dance. And then I went to St. Petersburg to continue my education there, because that's the school where all this Anna Pavlova, Nijinsky, all these people graduated. Fokin. Getting to this school, it means getting into this kind of museum thing, because I was going up on the stairs in this school, and you see the photos or the costumes of Anna Pavlova or Nijinsky. The feeling that surrounds you makes you feel that you are part of this magic things. And I was there, fortunately or unfortunately, after a year, Armenian government
recruited me back.
I came back. And in 1 year, I became the principal dancer with the National Ballet. And for 25 years, I was principal dancer with National Ballet, dancing all everything, all the leading roles, and all the classical repertoire.
In the Soviet era, the dancers, the artists, the writers, maybe not so much the writers if they were controversial, but you had a special status then, did you not?
Yes, I felt that, because I can tell you one story. When I was, because I was on the TV and everybody knows me, and when I was young, they gave me this artist emeritus title. So on the street, people can recognize me. And one day I was driving my car very, maybe fast, mm-hmm. and I saw the policeman coming behind me, and then he stopped me. I was kind of not the scared, but you don't have a right to stop
me. How dare you?
How dare you? And he came with the flowers, bouquet of the flowers. He saw me on the TV dancing Spartacus, and he said, "Oh, I want to stop you." Say, "So thank you for your dancing." I said, I was shocked.
And at one point you left Armenia. You left before the Karabakh movement began, before independence.
Yeah. I was part of this Stars of Soviet Ballet, and I was touring the world, going and presenting Soviet ballet from here, but there they were naming us as a Russian stars,
right.
Russian stars. So I was kind of not agree with them, sometimes fighting them, saying, "No, I'm Armenian, I'm not the Russian," but they say, "It's a Russian ballet, you are Russian."
You learn from the Russian school of ballet.
And exactly. And one of these trips when I was in Canada, performing there, they asked me to come to the Canada and to work with some small company, classical, Les Ballets Classiques de Montréal. So at the same time, they said, "So we will send you to Montreal to work with this small company to help them, and you have to do some project for local Armenian folk dance."
What year was this?
It was 86, and it was a little bit more freedom, more release.
Because you know, to think that, especially for me, for someone who lived in North America, the Soviet Union, you know, we have this impression, just as the Soviet Union has this impression of North America, but that they would allow you to come, because they were losing, you know, one of their prominent stars or dancers, artists.
Yeah, but it was part of the politics, you know. The up to today, the Bolshoi Theater, the Russia, they are using ballet as a tool, political tool, to impact, to do some problems, to solve something,
and to showcase at the end of the day, to showcase the creative ability of this country. You're showcasing it on an international stage.
Exactly, because the ballet has a power, because the ballet doesn't have a concrete language.
Right.
It's a language everybody understands in the world. So we don't need to, somebody doesn't need to translate. You can tell the story.
With your body.
With your body, small details of the costume and the story of our ancestors, or everything.
Okay, so they give you this offer to stay in Montreal and to...
It was 86. I went to Montreal, I did the program, I worked with a small company, and they came back after 3-4 months, and it was boiling in Armenia.
Yeah.
It was time when everybody was waking up, and the political things, art, it was kind of, I can't compare today, mm-hmm. It happens the same happens. I feel this this big energy, but the energy at that time, it was transformation, energy, power of the freedom, and then it starts going out in different ways. So, and I was part of this. I was standing the whole day
in Upper Square.
From Montreal, they were calling me back to go and continue. And my next project in Montreal, it was reflecting all what happening in Armenia. Even I had some conflict with the flag, with raising three colors.
So it was the Yara Queen, huh?
Yara Queen. It was very emotional time for me.
Isn't that interesting?
It was very interesting.
Did that change Rudolph, the artist, that movement, the 88 movement, and then independence? Did it impact?
Yes.
Sort of the course of your creativity, of your life?
Not the creativity, but kind of freedom or something was, kind of hope was in me that Armenia will become the independent and Armenia will do whatever needs Armenia, not only being apart and cornered in that big country. So the country was, we didn't realize that being alone as an independent country will have a lot of problems.
Sure.
It happened after. And part of this passion I was taking with me. And
back
as
to
I
the
said,
sort
yeah,
of the Armenian community in
Armenian
Canada.
Community, but the community didn't realize what they didn't understand, and it was making me mad.
But you know, you were sort of like an ambassador of the movement.
But that was my different part of my life, because after that I was invited to Washington to be part of, to become the faculty member of the Vaganov Academy. So I went to Washington. It was audition, of course.
Right.
It looks like some power took me to the Washington, locked me in this school, and they said, you have to go back to classical ballet. And for 4 years, I was teaching only classic, and it was revealing me something new. So for 25 years, I was a principal dancer, dancing all the classical ballet. I thought I'm into it, I know everything.
Every aspect of it.
But it turned out, no. So these 4 years took me more deep into the classical, and I start seeing things that I start connecting this movement of the classical ballet to back to 5,000 years before, that esoteric dances or ancient dances that was connecting them with cosmic energy. As a choreographer, I got into this, all these details, and I start seeing all these things.
And is that what led you to create your own ballet company, Arca?
The Washington Ballet invited me to join the faculty of the Washington Ballet and teach the company class. I got more freedom to create. I started my morning open classes where a lot of people from around the United States were coming take my classes. I combined the classical ballet with the martial art principle, with the breathing, inhale, exhaling. So all these complicated things, I started a new way of doing classical ballet. So it was crazy time for me. Thank you.
your children, Sona and Hagop, are also professional ballet dancers. And I was watching a clip of your daughter doing a solo performance with the duduk.
Yeah.
And then I was watching other, and to be honest, I mean, somebody who doesn't understand much from dance, I just, I appreciate it. What you were showing with your work, with your choreography, more than dance, for me, it was an appreciation of the human body, of the human form that was being showcased so much, and there was so much, it was so beautiful. Like your father with your children, sort of forcing them into the dance world, or was that just a natural evolution for them?
For my daughter, it was, she, you know, the
life
of
the
ballet.
She's beautiful, by the way. She's stunning, stunning Armenian woman.
Life of ballet dancer, it's, you have to be in the theater where your children, they were growing in the theater. They see everything. They learn all these movements you are doing intuitively or subconsciously. They dance, they do everything. So my family was part of this, the ballet world in Armenia. When she was 8 years old, she went to the ballet school, the same ballet school. And my son was
recruited like you were.
Exactly the same way. So they both was in a ballet. I sent my son to St. Petersburg to study ballet there, but it was very hard time. I was in Montreal and he was there. So I wasn't happy with this, and finally I took him to the Washington to my class. Mm-hmm. So he was my student, but that was the hardest time for me and for him too, because in a class I wasn't his father, I was a teacher.
Yeah. And you have to make that distinction.
And that's what I learned from my father, but he was kind of, and it was a conflict, big conflict with my son, until he, one day he said, I understand what you want.
He finally understood, huh?
Stop yelling or stop all these things. So I will obey, I will do whatever you wanted me to do, because I know that it's all for me. So from that day, everything changed, and he became a very, very famous dancer.
And what is he doing now? Where is he now?
He's now in Arizona, teaching the ballet and doing some choreography.
How does it feel for someone who's had such a sort of illustrious career in dance to watch your children on stage dancing?
It's very hard, I have to tell you, because I cannot watch them as a father, because father will always admire them. Oh, you are. But that's why our relation with my relation with my children, it's They see me as a judge, so it's hard. Sometimes I want to just relax and
enjoy and be proud, yeah. Right?
It happened, but for this we have to be together for a little bit longer time and relaxing and talking, and then I'm becoming the father.
Was it in 2009 you were invited back to lead the National Ballet Company?
Deep in me, I feel that I have to do something, because all this knowledge, all this experience I have now after living there for 20 years, I have to give back to my country. So in one of my trips in Armenia, I met the new minister of the culture, Hasmik Paulsen. Mm-hmm. She asked me to come and lead the national ballet. I said, no, I would like to do something to see how they will accept me, how they understand new way of this development of the ballet. And she said, sure. And in 2008 I came, I staged some the ballet here, and it was very hard time. Without finishing, I was ready just to leave because it was hard. It was very hard.
Because in your absence, what had happened to the School of Ballet in Armenia? Had they been able, under the very difficult circumstances the country was in, were they able to maintain that level of professionalism?
According to them, yes, they maintained.
But according to your standards?
According to what I know, what's going on in the world, in the ballet world, the time stopped for the ballet school here on that time when Soviet Union was collapsing. Yep, because it was under the Russian influence, the Russian school, Russian way of thinking, Russian everything. The whole country and the ballet was part of this country. A lot of Armenian dancers in that period of between 90 and 2010, they just left the country.
They left.
Trying to show that it moves.
It evolves. If you look 50 years ago, 80 years ago,
you have all this information. Please go on
online
online, and you will see what's happening and what kind of direction are.
Where do you see the future of Armenian ballet, Armenian art, theater, culture, country, politics? I mean, the country itself. Where do you see it?
It's a very complicated question because. The country for me, I came back, it's kind of boiling.
Still
boiling, and we have to give direction to this energy because otherwise it will explode or go to the wrong way. Now it's time to make very clear direction for everything. And particularly in a ballet, we have a young, these people, but mentality still, it's not clear what they want, but you need to put them in very strong direction, saying, spend your energy, time in this direction, and you will get the result.
But you need to have the vision to know, okay, where's the end game? Yep. You know, I think that's what we haven't figured out.
I have vision because I worked for more than 20 years in the United States, in Canada, and I know in which direction now the ballet, the dance is developing, evolving, and I know what we need, and I know our national needs also, and I see the same in politics, in art, in the media. The first, when I came to Armenia, I was full of these ideas of, you know, in a ballet, fifth position, it's not only shaping your body in that spiral movement, but also your mind, your spirit, and everything. And I was going to talk about this because I had the lecture back in Washington about the meaning, reason of this fifth position, all this movement. But it was not time for Armenia. And now, the hope is, because 3 years ago, when I start talking, they were looking at me.
Who's this crazy?
Who's this talking? Now there is some group which, when I start talking about this, when I'm teaching class, they are I see that, oh, they are there. Yeah. Maybe really they don't understand, but they want it.
You can see it in the eyes. You can see it in the expressions.
And that gives me this hope that we are on the right path.
I think so. I think so. Thanks to people like yourself. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to talk with us. I wish you much success, patience, mostly. And I'm sure that with your leadership, we will recreate sort of the Armenian School of Ballet.
Yeah, I'll do anything.
Sure. I can.